form there.
Absolutely, yeah, yeah, it's a good tune.
Good, good. On XFM 104.9, Ricky Gervais, Steve Merchant. Karl Pilkington, more importantly. Karl, come on then.
Right.
I need some education.
No, it's Rockbusters.
I know, but I need education. I need some education.
You know, but we've promised some Rockbusters.
Educating Ricky, I will be ditching before Christmas.
Why?
It will be going.
Why? Because there's nothing out there.
It's just struggling. I was thinking on the way in today, I can either do, doing something more with Steve, because we've done, like, the Ricky angle. Either, yeah, we can do,
educating Steve?
No, either, like, a bit of a call my bluff type thing, but it's like a con merchant, and I have to, like, trick you.
Okay.
Right,
merchant,
so I'm the
I like
con,
it.
And you're the merchant. And then, or I was thinking something that you just do, you do some work, and you have a moan for a bit, okay, and that's a bit, that's like a wine merchant, that you just like whine on about something.
The pun comes first with you, doesn't it?
You've worked out that first.
Yeah.
That's like, okay. I told you I've come up with a couple of sitcoms for me.
Go on.
One is I've got an imaginary navy called Merchant's Navy.
I've got a navy.
And the premise is I've got a navy. Yeah. And another one is I live in-
And that's as far as he's got as well.
Yeah, that's all I've come up with. If you've got any ideas there, Karl, yeah, that'd be much appreciated. Yeah. Another one is I live in quite a salubrious part of North London, and that's called Merchant of Little Venice. And I live in Little Venice. Again, I don't know what happens. I don't know what happens, but any ideas, Karl?
You know, I've got one where I play an Italian waiter, and it's called Shut Up a Gervais.
Yep.
That's
so that's the one we're working on now, actually, to follow up with The Office.
Do you like that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is it? Yeah. We'll do something with that.
Yeah.
But at the moment, we've got Rockbusters.
Okay. Okay.
So, these are mine. Number one. You've been dunking that for too long. That's LB.
Oh God, that's too easy.
I always tease them, don't I? Give them something to make them feel like they're gonna win something, and then I hit them hard with a tricky one.
That doesn't make sense. Yeah, go on.
So the first one. So that's the cryptic clue for a band or an artist. Their initials are LB, and the cryptic clue. You've been dunking that for too long.
Yeah.
So that's the first one. Second one. You won't be able to play that game in this pub because the table ain't big enough. Right. Could be an old artist, could be a new one, could be a band.
What's the initials?
FD. Alright? FD. You won't be able to play that game in this pub. The table ain't big enough. And the final one, well, I've had a rubbish day, so I'm happy it's over. Right? Yeah. That's the third cryptic clue, the initials being GK. Right?
Yeah.
Well, I've had a rubbish day, so I'm happy it's over. They're the three clues. All you gotta do is email in ricky.gervais.
That's great! That's genius.
Which one?
The last one.
Alright.
That is genius. That's the best one you've ever done.
Alright. Ricky.gervais.
That's great.
And then the middle one. UK.
Okay.
Email in them three answers, you win the stuff. We have still got educating Ricky.
Go on, let's have one, let's have one.
No, I'll give you the titles.
Give me the titles, yeah, got you. Yeah.
Right, you've got, three bits of info that's gone on in the world.
Yeah.
Or,
possibly.
Information.
Older times? Never go further back than the 17th century, do we?
Well, no, let's make it clearer. There's three bits of information that people have put on the net. Yeah. Whether or not they're true.
Well,
yeah. Definition.
And that he still gets it a little bit wrong in translation.
Yeah.
And sort of adds bits to it. Yeah, go
right,
on.
So we've got,
I love it when he plays out those historical dialogues.
Yeah.
You know, it's like the 15th century where he goes, so anyway, a bloke says to himself, I'll tell you what I'll do.
So the horse isn't happy.
Yeah.
Yeah, go on.
Right, so the three that you've got to pick from, you've got, get your kit on, we're off down the butchers.
Get your kit on, we're off down the butchers, yeah!
We've got, wash up with you.
Wash up with you! Yeah!
And, the last one, I couldn't really think of a good title for, so it's just, why don't they just get a diary or some paper or something?
We've got to make
this into a book.
It's mine, Steve's favourite bit of the whole show. This is what we do this show for now. Educating Ricky.
Yeah.
Go for it, Karl.
You said learning can't be fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll go for the one. What's the one about the butcher going down the butcher shop?
You've got to get your kit on, we're off down the butcher's.
Yeah.
You going for that one?
Yeah.
Well, do you know the saying, don't let the cat out of the bag?
Yeah.
do you know what it means?
Yeah, don't give away a secret.
Right. Well, do you know how it came about?
No.
Well, ages ago. Before, like,
ages ago. 17th century?
Yeah, before, like.
Yeah, yeah, 17's good. Yeah.
Before, like, you know, proper butchers and Dewhurst and supermarkets and that. You used to get these blokes who sold meat,
right? Butchers, they were called then, I think.
Yeah, yeah, but the difference was they didn't stay in the same place, they moved about, right? So they'd turn up on a street corner,
right,
and he'd have, like, loads of carrier bags of, like...
Carrier bags?
Yeah, with, you know, with meat in and that, and people would
plastic
be like,
carrier bags.
Yeah, with whatever. Mobile butcher on them.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, so,
had an email address.
Yeah, go on.
People went, right, yeah, I need some meat, right? So they'd, they'd go up to this bloke and, say, what have you got? And he'd say, well, I've got a, you know, you can have a bag full of pig, or you can have, whatever, a bag full of chicken, whatever. Yeah. And they'd go, yeah, how much? They go, oh, you know, call it a fiver, whatever.
Yeah.
And, they'd buy them, and to make more money, they didn't always fill the bag with what they said was in it.
Oh, and yeah, I thought that might be the case.
Right? Yeah. So what
did they
used to
put
do?
A cat in there?
Yeah.
But I don't see what,
Okay, so sometimes they would put a cat in the bag and pretend it was chicken or whatever else.
Yeah, so
why was a cat any cheaper than a chicken?
Because cats are wandering around the streets, aren't they? Chickens aren't. So they'd get a chicken, they'd put a chicken on the top so that when they look in it, they'd go, yeah, that's all right. Got a bag full of chicken. They'd get home to make the dinner,
yeah,
and they'd be like, what are we having tonight? And they'd go, well, you'll never guess. And they'd have, like, you know, well, you can have a chicken leg and... You know,
but it wouldn't be, it would be a cat. Yeah. They'd have to defrost a pizza.
Yeah.
Oh.
Did they mind that they were eating cat then, in those days?
He didn't say. He just was saying about the saying, don't let the cat out of the bag. It's like, you know, if they see that, they're gonna go mad.
I'm mildly disappointed with this story. It's all right if it's true, but yeah, it's something about it, it's just... I want to know more. He always leaves it. Is it Karl doesn't quench your thirst for knowledge? He creates more. I don't know if that's a good thing or not.
Well, yeah, he's like the pot noodle of information.
Yeah, do you know, he never. I want to go.
I'm not nourished by it.
It's like if for every fact he tells me, there's 10 others that spring up that I have to get clear.
Well, so it was the people that were doing this. It was the dodgy butchers that coined this phrase. Were they saying to each other, "Don't let the cat out of the bag"? I.e., what I mean by that, Jack, is don't let them see the cat.
Yeah.
What we've stuffed in there.
Yeah.
Dodgy butcher. That's another phrase, isn't it?
So that's the first one.
Is that a euphemism or is it?
Yeah.
Dodgy butcher.
As his meat delivered around the back.
Sure.
So that's that one. So let's get your kit on.
What was that
then?
It's a euphemism for homosexuality.
Okay. And meat, presumably, in that means different things.
It doesn't. It's a word that is also a male
would it
bird.
Would it mean chicken or cat necessarily in that context? Or well, I suppose it could.
Yeah. Karl's look at him. Karl looks at you like a cat.
Yeah.
Whenever we leave him behind, if we don't talk like straight at him and let him see our lips moving, and it's, you know, monosyllabic and very easy to understand. Look, he's lost. He's lost in that conversation. There, he just drifted off, didn't he, Karl?
No, I just was also thinking on animals and that, something else I was going to use.
Go on.
Was,
This isn't a radio show, is it? I just suddenly caught myself, this is nothing.
I told you that before, it's been bad today.
No, but I mean, it's the way, this casual way that, it's like we almost have no regard for our listener. And I'm not proud of that, I just don't know what to do about it. Do you know what I mean? I don't know how to do this properly. I mean, we're just chatting here. I mean, it's only Anderson who's seen through us, and that surprises me that more people haven't. I mean, what are the figures like? Do people listen to this show?
I'll find out for you.
You keep saying that.
But, yeah, there's this parrot, and, apparently, it lives
I mean, Rick, it's unique, if nothing else. I mean, when you wake up with Woken tomorrow, you're not even going to hear him start a line with there was this parrot.
Go on, there was this parrot, yeah, go on.
And it can talk and that. Someone's obviously, you know, tore it out, how to speak and that. And, it flew away.
Oh.
And it's living in this church, right? And, people are at the church doing hymns and that. And then
trouble's brewing.
In between
if
the hymns.
If that parrot was owned by an old, miner who used to swear a lot,
well,
then the vicar is gonna be really annoyed. That vicar. Yeah. That vicar's gonna, go on.
I just hope he stays quiet, Rick, during the vicar's sermons.
Yeah, go on.
Have you read it?
No, go on.
Have you read it?
No, go on, because that's what happens, right?
Go on, tell us, Karl.
During the hymns, it's sort of effing and jeffing and stuff.
Effing and jeffing?
Yeah. And everyone's like going, oh, you know, it's quite funny, really. No, it doesn't know what it's doing. Everyone's having a laugh.
Yeah.
But it's causing a havoc at funerals.
When did this happen?
Not years ago.
John was a much loved man.
He was a wanker.
Yeah. So anyway, so that was another
story.
What
can you say about Uncle John?
Bollocks.
Oh God, I love the fact that when you look at things, you go, that's interesting. A parrot swears at funerals.
That'd be amazing.
And it stays with you. You see, for a simple man, you retain an awful lot of knowledge. It's just all rubbish.
It's all
you. Do you know what I mean? If you just replaced all this rubbish with good stuff, you'd be an intellectual.
Yeah.
Really. Because, I mean, your attention is fantastic.
Yeah.
So I lose you again there, did I? Was it the word retention?
We've still got, Wash Up With You.
Yeah. Should we play a record and do Wash Up With You?
Yeah, we'll play a bit of Aqualunga.
Aqualunga! Alright, that's Aqualung. Good time's gonna come, innit? Right, Karl, come on in, educating Ricky. So, don't let the cat out of the bag, that's where that comes from.
Mm-hmm.
Comes from a crafty butcher. Right, go on in.
So the next little headline is, Wash Up With You.
Wash Up With You, go on.
You wanna know about that?
Yes.
It's a survey that they did. Survey that they did this week.
They?
Yeah, some university did some survey.
Brilliant.
Did a world test on washing up.
Yeah.
And each country were given 140 pots to clean. Brits were the quickest. Yeah.
Yeah.
Turkey were the slowest at washing up.
The Turks.
It's not because the little fellas that work in the kitchens were no, is it?
They can't reach.
Spain. Spain were the cleanest, and the Germans were pretty good as well, so.
I don't know where to start with this. Honestly, Steve, I don't know where to start with that. Look at his face.
It was really light, right? We've had the parrot, right? These are the things that I found the parrot. Right, I've told you about the dog in the car wash.
Right, you didn't tell me about that. You said there's a car wash for a dog, that's all you told me.
Yeah,
but the parrot, you said there's a parrot. What? It's a problem at funerals.
Yeah.
That's nothing.
And,
do you understand?
And
they used to eat cats.
What else have we got? There's an elephant in India with sore feet.
Why?
There's an elephant in India with sore feet.
Now I'm interested. Why?
Dancing.
Why?
See, yeah, I didn't write that much
about it. He's trying to break Roy Castle's record. He's still going.
Go on, what is it? Think.
It's an elephant and it was really old. It was about 76.
Right.
And it had sore feet because it's old and
they don't make stairs that big, do they?
The roads are bad and that.
Yeah, go
so,
on.
They said, what are we going to do? And the town was like, oh, you know, we're used to seeing it around. It's part of the thing, you know, we don't want it to have sore feet.
Yeah.
So they got some slippers made for it. And it had like a picture of the elephant looking happy wearing some slippers.
I love Karl, his world! Where did you see this picture?
That was on the internet.
Right.
That's a lesson though for any elephants listening. You know, don't wear stilettos to work every day.
No.
Because it can do your feet in.
So that
it's don't elephants have really bad memories?
No, they have really good memories.
Oh, do they?
Mm.
Yeah. Oh, well, that's good then. No, I just thought they'd forget where they put them. I thought there was something about elephants having bad memories and that.
It goes on, where's my slippers?
Yeah.
I'm sure I left them by the Tesla.
So, sorry, there's an elephant walking around wearing slippers?
Yeah, that's in
what
India.
What kind of slippers? Those sort of old man ones with the sort of checkers.
Well, round design. Ones, I imagine.
Yeah.
Big round ones.
There was that going on.
And is it happening? Is it happier? I mean, does it feel more satisfying?
Yeah, it looked it.
Did it look it? How can you tell the elephants, please?
What else is there? There was a woman who's had a breast insured for 150 grand.
Right.
Okay.
Okay,
any more information there?
What? Third party fire and theft?
Don't know, it just said it had a picture of her with them, like, you know, out. I just thought, yeah, you should get them covered.
He's done another real joke!
Brilliant, that's a proper joke.
He's done, look at his little face, he smiles!
I'd like to see you on one of the sort of TV panel games. If they could bring back sort of celebrity squares,
yeah.
It'd be amazing as the centre square.
Oh, that would be incredible.
Or on the countdown in Dictionary Corner.
I imagine him in Dictionary Corner.
Well, I'd come up with cat,
yeah.
if that helps at all.
Yeah. Memblant.
Yeah, what does that mean, Karl?
Just anything you want it to mean. And what I've got, There's a dog that's got a cough in Singapore because it smokes 20 a day. Right, okay, another one.
No, it was the last one in it, so yeah. We'll say that the last one we've got is why don't
you. Sorry, what was that? Wash up with you, that was it. But they put survey of washing pots and pans.
I didn't understand. You said Italy were the cleanest.
No, Spain.
No, Brits were the quickest.
Yeah. We were the quickest, but Italy was the
Spain
cleanest.
Was the cleanest.
Turkey were the slowest.
Yeah. Yeah.
Spain were the cleanest.
But why weren't we cleaner? Because we were washing up. Why were we not paying attention to the
rubbish? We did it quickly,
but I don't understand what it was being rated on.
Who was doing it? Was it Lynette Newman or Ainsley Harriet?
She's quick. Both of them are quick.
Yeah.
Well, they've got like kind of slaves that do it for them.
Did we use fairy liquid?
Don't know. It didn't have.
Did we use a whole bunch of Boy Scouts?
Didn't say that.
Just like Lynette.
He just said, you know, that.
Who had the softest hands?
So I didn't say.
Why is it we don't get notified that this is taking place?
I don't know.
When I was a kid, no one ever said, you know, we need recruits because we're doing a survey on who can wash up the quickest.
Are you disappointed in yourself with that one, Karl?
It is pretty dull. To be fair, and that is why we've got to bring in either con merchant or a wine merchant.
Or shut up with your face.
Yeah.
Would you be able to, if I asked you, if I put you on the spot in the next, sort of after the next record, would you be able to give an example of how con merchant would work? I mean, is there something you could do just to sort of experiment?
Should we play a record?
I can do better than that.
What?
Ads.
Go on.
Oh.
Travis on XFM 104.9 on Ricky Gervais with me, Steve Merchant, Karl Pilkington. We're doing Educating Ricky. Right, final one. Come on, Karl.
Right, what was it? It was, why don't they just get a diary or some paper or something to write on?
Yeah.
Because
snappy.
I couldn't think of a heading for it. It's basically,
go on.
People who have tattoos, I've never understood it, right? That they have something put on their arm.
Right, sorry. Have we started the education? Is this part of it? Are you educating me? This is something that I will be useful in my life that I didn't know about.
Yeah.
Go on then.
No, it's just that they've got a machine out, right, that does tattoos. You come up with a design you want, and you sort of, this machine scans it, and you put your arm in this thing, and you press print or whatever. And then it does the tattoo on your hand or on your
arm. Like loads of little needles that follow a pattern.
Yeah,
computer,
basically.
Is it?
Yeah.
Is it a real tattoo? It's a proper one.
The fella said.
Well, as long as it goes out, it pierces the skin with a
I just wondered if it's one of those kind of, you know, those kind of.
No, it must be lots of little needles or a moving needle that can go along.
Sorry, but how is this cleaned? Like in between each person.
Don't know. Probably. I don't know.
Well, no. It's only that if it's one needle, it's just the head, isn't it? If it's one needle that moves, right. Does it like a like loads of little?
What are we gaining from a machine doing it?
Just because you know they're not going to sort of mess it up.
But hold on, how do you keep your arm still? Because your skin moves slightly. It's the machine sort of
strapped to your arm.
Right.
And the fella said that the tricky thing was in all this, it was the fact that you know, nobody would let him test it out on anyone else, so he had to do it himself.
But did it work? Because the thing is with a tattoo artist, they can see when your skin's moved and they can see what they've done and they keep wiping it and looking, whereas a machine's just got to trust itself. Yeah. So I think one needle could go wrong. If it was a lot of needles, that it just came down, like, you know, 1,000 needles that was an imprint.
Yeah.
Obviously I'm asking someone who's hasn't delved any further than there's a machine that can give you a tattoo. That's all you've got at the moment, isn't it?
Well, I'm, yeah, basically.
That's all you've got?
I mean, that's what I've got because I'm not a fan of tattoos, I don't.
But where did you read this again?
This was,
internet?
This was on the internet, yeah, it was, yeah.
okay.
And I just don't understand why people do it. That's what got me attention. Because me,
Sorry, what have I learned from this?
That if you wanted to get one, you know, you can get one done by a machine now. You know, people say machines are sort of taking over and that. And there's another one. But it's just the fact, I mean, I don't know.
So give us the snappy title of this education again.
Why don't they just get a diary or some paper or something to write it on? That's why I always think when I see people with loads of tattoos, like there's that fella who we were talking about the other week in Scotland who was covered 99% in tattoos. Yeah. It's just like, what have you done that for?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? You can't get rid of it now. You've done it now.
Yeah.
One of my uncles, right, Tattoo Stan, he's just caked in them.
Tattoos.
Right.
I don't think he's my proper uncle, but it's just like, my dad's
Tattoo Stan!
No, my dad's
That's a province in Russia, isn't it?
My dad's got loads of mates who,
when
like,
you say he's not
names.
Your proper uncle.
I do you know how, like, when
just
someone comes
around
you, all right, Uncle Stan.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And it was like, it was, my dad had loads of mates like that. There was John the Screw.
Right. So, he either works in a prison, or he liked to have sex.
Cabby. Cab driver.
Okay.
There was Jimmy the Hat. I don't know what he
Jimmy
did.
The Hat?
Yeah.
And, did he wear a hat?
No.
No.
There was Fred the Veg.
You sure he wasn't a relative?
Sorry.
Fred the Veg used to get us like big bags of potatoes and that.
Fred
the
Veg, okay.
And there was Tattoo Stan.
Right.
And he was just caked in them, and I used to always look at him thinking, why have you done that? I must have only been like, you know, six
I suppose
or seven.
If you're born with a name like Tattoo Stan.
Exactly.
You're destined,
sorry,
aren't you,
really?
Were
they like a 1950s gang?
I'm worried about, like, I'm worried about-
doing a bank job.
What was his name? The Hat? What was his
Jimmy,
name?
Jimmy the Hat.
I'm worried about Jimmy the Hat.
Yeah.
Not having a hat.
I don't understand it.
Are you sure he didn't have a hat?
Not when I met him.
Did he ever wear a hat?
I didn't see him that much.
Do you think it was a joke, like, you know, when your mate sort of like, you know, 8 foot and huge, you call him Little John or Tiny?
Mm.
Do you think
well, the fact that he never wore
yeah,
a hat.
They went, hold on, I've noticed something about Jim. Go on. No hat. And I go, oh, true, let's call him Jim the Hat.
Jim the Hat, yeah. But me Uncle Stan, he had like loads of them, he did them himself.
Oh dear.
And it was always that thing.
What was it things like?
It was, he had like
the cross.
Cut here.
Cut
one,
here,
on
made in
neck.
Britain.
And if you're going to do them yourself, I'd say at least make sure you're sort of a good drawer.
Yeah.
And don't do it in the mirror so it comes out backwards.
Well, that was the other thing. But like, I remember he did, I mean, names are all right. He had like all his kids' names down his arm.
And, what are they called?
Yeah.
Oh, God, it is.
Tattoo Stan Junior.
Yeah.
And,
Paul shits the bed.
I'm trying to
oh, Wubby Kate.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah,
Frankie never amounts to anything.
Oh God!
So he had like
Johnny. I don't think he's mine.
So he did all this stuff. I don't even know why I'm telling you about Tattoo Stan.
No, nor do I, Carl.
Hey,
so, to be honest,
I don't know if maybe you just have to picture this. For my picture, my sister had to take a photo once. She was working in like a factory. Not to denigrate people who work in factories, but there happened to be a particularly oddball, kind of lank-haired, weird guy living working in this factory, and he made his own. He did his own tattoos, and she took a photo of it because she was so extraordinary. He'd drawn it himself. Now bear in mind, it was the kind of thing you saw when you were doing art when you were like 15. This is the sort of person who designed their own. Like rock, heavy rock album cover.
Yeah,
he's that sort of person. So, I mean, like,
was it a dragon with breasts?
You're not far off, Rick.
No,
you're not far off. I'll tell you what it was. He had this tattooed on his back. It took up his entire back. She took a photo of it for me. He drew it himself. He had it tattooed himself, and it was just too much detail. Too much detail for a tattoo. It needs to be fairly simple, I think, to make it
cut. Mm-hmm.
It was. It was a naked female vampire having a shower.
Why was she having a shower?
Having a shower, that's why she was naked.
Yeah.
And so she had- She'd been out, presumably,
a lot of blood.
Yeah, well, she was naked, so you could see her naked body.
Yeah.
She's quite a beautiful vampire,
yeah.
Relatively speaking.
Yeah.
Although the symmetry of her face was somewhat off.
Yeah.
The only thing I think that gave
well,
it away-
Well, bad spine.
Was that she had, she did have some pointed teeth. And
right.
I think that was how you knew she was a vampire.
Right. Was she looking-
but,
was she
having a shower was-
Yeah,
very
that is
specific.
Weird, isn't it?
he said to the eye,
listen, I want a naked bird, right? But I don't want to be gratuitous. He goes, well, you can put her in a shower, because then they went,
that at least gives some kind
yeah,
of justification.
That's the plot. That's the plot. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's justified within the story if she's in a shower. Sure, sure. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, we'll have that.
So,
Carl.
So.
Yeah. Okay. Any other nicknames your friends of your family had?
What was your nickname, Carl?
Just Pilky.
Because for a minute I thought Karl the Veg would have made a lot of sense.
Yeah, Karl the Veg. And why has your dad got a little tattoo, dopey twat, on his arm?
Right, we'll do the answers to Rotbusters next, yeah?
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Buzzcocks. Still sounds brilliant, that.
It is a cracker.
They're from Manchester as well, Karl. So they've got a little bit of pride there, eh?
I think one of them's one of my mate's dads.
Really?
Yeah, I think so.
What's his nickname?
Well, his name was, I don't really want to say his name.
Okay.
Laurie, his first name was.
Yeah. Still is, probably.
Yeah. He was a good
Well, you know those little fellas at school that didn't know each other, weren't related and weren't friends, because it would be too obvious, that they had webbed, hands and big heads?
Yeah.
What were they, did they have any nicknames?
Again, too obvious, isn't it?
Yeah. Go on.
Well, oh, big head, or, you know.
Sure.
Oh, I bet you got that juggling, or...
Frog twins.
Yeah.
Can I just interrupt you guys, because we've just had an email here, I hate to query you, Karl, and you're educating Ricky sections. I know you put a lot- don't read this, let me just read it for you. Just had an email here from Olivia, and this has also been corroborated by someone else, I forget who it was. She was just- she just tuned in, and she just heard you explaining the expression, letting the cat out of the bag.
So.
It's all to do with cats that were put in bags by dodgy butchers. Possibly the 17th century, we're not too sure. anyway, she claims- let me see, she says, she uses both the words twaddle and crap. In relation to your definition. She says, letting the cat out of the bag is an old shipping expression from when sailors used to get flogged for their misdemeanors. The cat,
letting the cat
is the cat
of
nine tails,
of
which
is
a kind of whip thing that you, they used to keep hanging in a bag below deck. If it was discovered that a sailor had done something wrong, the cat would be let out of the bag and you'd get a whipping.
Of course it is.
Don't let the cat out of the bag, you need to cover something up with a
She's talking nonsense, right?
No, she's not. That's
she
the
is.
Truth. That's
because
the truth.
One I read about that was, there's not enough room in here to swing a cat, right? And that was people who worked on a boat.
Yeah, well, that's the same. Well, that's fine. They're
the same
expressions for the
They're not going to keep going on about people working on a boat to get loads of sailors.
You can't have two phrases about the same thing.
Can't
they're
these
not
sailors
gonna
have got nothing to do with their time.
Think how many
just coming up. Stuff
think
like
how
that.
Many metaphors have birds in them, and you know it's ridiculous. Why can't you have? You can have as many sayings as you like about anything, Karl.
Yeah,
there's
well,
not a rule.
Whatever.
They don't go. We've made one up about the cat and nine tails.
Well, cheers for that, Oliver.
Olivia.
Olivia.
Yeah.
Don't see your email coming up with the Rockbusters answers, so let's give them out. The first one was, you've been dunking that for too long.
Yeah.
That was LB.
Limp Biscuit. Yeah, got that one.
The third one, we'll jump to that one because you've got it. Well, I've had a rubbish day, so I'm happy it's all over. That was GK.
That's a great one.
That's
Gladys Knight.
Gladys Knight.
That's
brilliant, Karl.
And the one that you're both having a problem with, you won't be able to play that game in this pub. The table ain't big enough. FD.
Go on.
Fats Domino. Yeah?
What?
Dominoes. You play dominoes in a pub. The domino's fat. Pub tables are quite small. You won't be able to play that game in this pub. Fats Domino.
Rubbish.
So, do you want to pick a winner?
Rubbish.
Winner,
well,
winner?
You say it's rubbish, but plenty of people got the right answer.
Rubbish.
Who do you want to go with?
The bunch of slightly rubbish prizes is going to Elliot Kay from Chigwell in Essex. Well done to Elliot.
Can we just get a little email off Anders? Because I think he must. Well, I think we've probably turned him round with this show.
I thought so.
I think he's going to be saying, coming to us with his tail between his legs, saying, "Sorry, lads, blinding show. I was wrong, you were right."
Yep.
Yeah.
Alright.
Song for the Lovers is very exciting this
week. We haven't had a song for the Lovers or the Ladies for quite some time. Let's combine the two.
Sorry,
and
sorry.
John Martin, May You Never. Let's end with
beautiful
that this week.
Track.
We'll see you next time.
Bye. He's got everything. He's like one of our best rock stars. I'm Ricky Gervais.
Hello there.
You're Steve Merchant.
I am indeed.
Karl Pilkington over there. Big day today.
Really?
Yeah, for Karl. He hasn't been looking forward to it. He's been whinging in the week. A couple of things. He thinks he's overworked. He thinks he's overworked here, and he's stressed. He's got to do DIY. MTV are coming in, right, to give him the chance of his a lifetime to do a little screen test, and he's going, "Well, I'm not going to look good, am I? They're not going to know why." He said, "Well, I've got a round head and I'll be wearing headphones." And he's not made an effort. He thinks, "Oh, they'll put him off." He said, "I won't even press record." He's got a spot on his head.
Uh-huh.
I mean, you know, I mean, also-
you're not looking forward to it. You're not excited about it. It's a great opportunity.
Why is that a great opportunity?
To get on MTV?
No, but-
it's money for old rope, isn't it?
Yeah, but look what's happened to people like, Jeremy Spake, whatever his name is. And all
Jeremy Spake, yeah.
Yeah, and,
yeah, slightly different. Slightly different.
Why is it?
Well- You're making it in the industry, and you've got something to give. He happened to be around when they were filming an airport.
No,
do you see the difference?
Alright, the other one then, who's on a boat.
Same thing, although at least she had a skill, you know, she can sing, you know.
Well, she is just good. I think it can all go wrong, do you know what I mean?
Well, of course it can. so conceited in your little room moaning about nothing happening in the world. You know, he wanted to stop educating Ricky because nothing happened. He said, look what happened last week. I scoured the net. He said, all I found was a dog in a car wash and a parrot and a vicar.
Uh-huh. Right? I tell you what, there ain't much more going on this week.
We're talking, listen, me and Steve, yesterday, we took a day off to prove you wrong, and we've come up with two of the most incredible things I told you about, and they're amazing. So there are things out there, or is it just go for truth. Go for truth and science and discovery.
The
fact is stranger than fiction. You don't have to revert to God and ghosts.
I know, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
But the funny thing is, you know, like, the last couple of weeks I've been saying there's not much going on.
Yeah.
I found out when I was looking that there was a day in 1930, right? It was a Good Friday. There was no news. There was nothing going on. They had to put a music video on or something on the telly because there was nothing going on.
Play a record. We're going to play some classic tracks today. This is Debaser. Pixies, Debaser. I was looking forward to playing that. Okay, I said, Karl, I'll play that. I was looking. He put it on. Lauren just called through and said, we played that in the last half hour.
Embarrassing.
Yeah. So it's what really is the point of having a producer if he doesn't check things out? So, I mean, it's a good track. I mean, I'm sorry if you heard that twice in the last hour.
Listen to everything all the time. I've been running around. I get in early on a Saturday.
You got in about the same time as me.
I went out and bought you some biscuits, so you're happy. I put the coffee on.
Yeah.
I sorted what prizes we're going to give away. I've been running to the library getting you certain tracks.
Yeah.
I can't listen all the time. I'm doing my best.
Oh, I'm not sure it's good enough, Tom. I mean, I'm worried when MTV come in, if they've heard this kind of shoddy production, they're going to start to wonder what you're
playing the same songs every 5 minutes.
Yeah, no,
anyway.
Sorry, are you sort of overworked because you were on Zoe Ball show talking?
Oh, hello, what's going on here?
Well,
I seem to remember, Rick, he was a nobody that got a chance to come on air and talk about that.
Guess what he was talking about on Zoe's show?
Oh, hello.
All the jellyfish stuff and all that.
Recycling material that you've done on this show.
I phoned in, right, and I went, stop doing materials. He just hung up on me.
That well, I had a job to do.
Who do you think you are? Ego has just gone through
the
roof.
Hang on a minute.
What?
I had a job to do in the week. They asked me to drive the desk for Zoe, right?
Zoe,
if she talks to you, you can't just ignore her.
Yes, you can.
Who
is she? Right, who does she think she is? You made a promise to us, a pact, that you were our kind of
monkey.
Yeah.
What can I do if someone takes time off? I've got to do it. It's my job.
Yeah, but you don't have to talk. You don't have to use.
You're the head of production. We've given you this special gig. This is like taking you out weekends.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, if we find out you're getting too much excitement in the week, we'll have to just calm it down.
Yeah.
Get another little.
Well, that's it now. Anyway, it was only last week.
I feel like kind of solid. I feel betrayed. It's like you were having an affair behind our back.
Yeah.
And you rumbled it.
He was doing all the stuff. Jellyfish and this, jellyfish
that. Yeah, because she was asking. And I thought it was a good way of promoting this show, actually.
Oh, did you mention the show?
Yeah, I did at some point.
What did you say?
I just said more about that on Saturday afternoons.
So you talk twice. I only heard you talk once. So you're talking all the time.
Well, about five times in the week. In the full week. Five times.
Theory, right?
And one, it was just stuff.
You could never be a monk, could you? Chatting away all the time. Right, what have we got?
Ball as well, to be honest. I feel Ball's slightly responsible for it.
Yeah.
She can't find her own, you know, Gibbon to get on the show.
Yeah.
She can't find her own kind of, you know, loser, then don't start stealing ours. Outrageous.
Well, coming up, right,
we'll get Fat Boy Slim in.
Indeed.
Next.
Yeah.
Saturday, if you're listening, Slim.
Yeah.
Come in on the show.
What's his name? Ernie or something?
What's his name?
Norman.
Oh, yeah.
Ernie!
Yeah.
Oh, that's great, Ernie Ball.
Yeah.
He wouldn't change his name. That's great.
Anyway,
coming
up today, we have got Educating Ricky.
Right, okay. Is this the last one? You've promised it might be.
I believe there's a book out that might help me with this feature, so we'll see how it goes. I was thinking of new features in the week. I've got, I wanted to come up with a what to do celebrity fact club.
Celebrity fact club, alright.
I've just got to get some celebrities in first.
Okay.
Before we can kick that off, so maybe in the new year.
Maybe
Zoe Ball,
And Cook, start off.
Maybe, right. And I've also got,
Cook and Ball stories.
Yeah. That's nice.
Good one.
Cheers. Thanks, Karl.
Yeah. Maybe you could sell that to Zoe's show.
And, I'm also thinking through the Ricky hole.
Through the Ricky hole, okay.
What's that?
That's, I'm quite.
No, you just got the title again, haven't you? Yeah. Okay, play record.
So, Rockbusters coming up as well.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Wu-Tang Clan, Gravel Pit on XFM 104.9.
We're playing some great music today. Yeah, I wonder if we should maybe, you know, it's getting towards Christmas to think about others. Should we dedicate the show to all the people in the world who maybe are less privileged and less fortunate than us?
No.
No? Okay.
Have you got to do the prizes for the,
Prizes? Okay. Alright, so screw those who are less fortunate, is what TV's Ricky Gervais thinks. Rick, I know you're a big fan, of the likes of Bryan Adams, Robert Palmer, Alien, Ant Farm, and, obviously, ZZ Top.
Yeah.
And so you'll be enjoying the best air guitar album in the world.
Brilliant.
Ever, Volume 2.
Yeah, sure.
Fantastic.
Well, Volume 1 wasn't enough. There wasn't enough.
Again, we've seemed to be able to give one of these away every week. Are you just not sending these out? I mean, these are the same prizes we started this game with, I think, a couple of weeks back. Are you just not sending the prizes out?
Yeah, but I want to give, like, more people a chance, because if 1 week they listen in and think, God, I wouldn't mind winning that.
Sure.
If you've got more copies of it, they'll go, well, I'll listen next week.
Okay.
Yeah.
So again, this is one of those the best songs you've heard on an advert ever album.
Mainly mobile phones?
Mainly mobile phone adverts, yeah. Although there is the Smash Mouth one, which is used in the Ford Fiesta TV.
Oh yeah. Walking on the Sun or something.
I forget what it is. The Smashing Pumpkins album that we've given away in the past again.
Yeah.
Obviously got a bulk order of those that can't shift them. Wild Weather. I don't know who's interested in this.
Is that a double box set VHS of different weather?
That's amazing.
Yeah, that is amazing.
It's presented by Donald McIntyre. It's a thrilling trip with the most exciting forces of our wild and turbulent world.
So I'm right in saying it's a double VHS video set of different weather?
Yes.
Brilliant.
Yeah, no, it's got, I mean, it includes the fastest winds, the hottest desert, and the biggest rain machine on the planet. That's something I think you have to.
Oh, God. I wonder if they're bringing out another box set, Soil.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just goes through different mud.
and this you may be of interest. I've read good reviews of the DVD of this. It's a two disc set. The Wicker Man, the classic 70s film, but it's got a bunch of extras.
That's actually worth having.
I would probably throw the rest away.
But the Wicker Man, get it on DVD, and it's quite very interesting.
Yeah, but you'll enjoy that.
So what this Rockbusters, is it?
Yeah. Oh, that's for Rockbusters.
Brilliant. Well, I say get the ball rolling now.
What, of Rockbusters?
Yeah, get the ball rolling.
I don't know. I mean, tease them, Rick. Don't sort of spunk all the good stuff early on. I mean,
well,
that's dynamite.
You can say spunk. I can't. Go on.
Well, we've got, actually, it's quite good moving it about, because we might have some new listeners there.
Yeah.
And I would have also.
Yeah. Not after last week.
No.
Right, okay, so if you haven't heard it before, I'll give you some initials. It's like initials of an artist or of a band.
It's Blockbusters.
And a cryptic clue to who the band is. There's two easy ones, one difficult one. first one is, that'll never get off the ground.
Right.
Yeah.
That'll never get off the ground.
Never get off the ground is the clue.
Not LZ.
The initials are LZ.
You are joking.
Two easy ones.
Right.
Yeah?
Okay.
Right, and then you've got that woman's got her husband's gloves and a pair of her own.
Right. Say it again.
That woman has got a pair of her husband's gloves and she's got a pair of her own. That's HH. Right. It's a bit of a difficult one. And then the last one. You'll get a right load of bacon off them, right?
You'll get what?
A right load of bacon off them. That's L.
L.
Yeah. So You'll get a right load of bacon off them.
Uh-huh.
So first one, that'll never get off the ground. LZ. That woman has got her husband's gloves and she's got a pair of her own. That's HH.
Brilliant.
And you'll get a right load of bacon off them. That's L.
And so it's an email only competition.
Email only, ricky.gervais@xfm.co.uk, and we pick a winner before the end. So,
and they can win at Wicker Man.
The weather.
Best of the weather. Weather.
The best of the weather. That would be amazing. The best of the weather.
As a compilation, Channel 4.
Exactly. Winds like to vary.
I love 1976
weather.
Remember
this one from August 1979?
Oh, it's warm, isn't it? Oh, this is warm, isn't it?
The best of the weather.
I'll tell you what. You remember how we always played like great music, usually?
You've not got another one, have you?
This is David Bowie driving Saturday.
David Bowie driving Saturday. That's a great track, isn't it? A crash course for the ravers, eh? That's what this show is, isn't it, Carl? Crash course for the ravers. They tune and they go, what? That's
That's so cool. I wish I was like Karl Pilkington.
You reckon?
Yeah, definitely. You forgot to read your mum's clues out, didn't you?
Yeah,
she's just for fun only. This is Karl's mum. She listened 1 week and now she sends him a little example of Rockbusters every week.
She's got what did she send? This group would go well with your Christmas dinner.
Cranberries?
Yeah. They make a few good cupboards.
They make a few good cupboards?
Yeah.
The carpenters.
I was thinking of EMF.
I was thinking B&Q. The B&Q's.
This group thinks of lots of things.
This group thinks of lots of things.
Yeah.
Go on.
Imagination. I think they're the best ones.
Yeah, they're the best ones. Obviously we want the worst ones then.
Here's one more. She'd really like Blackpool.
She'd really like Blackpool. She'd really like Blackpool.
Fairground attraction. Not bad.
Yeah.
Not bad.
Right, so, there's,
does she write anything else in the letter? Or does she just send them, like, on a scrawled on the back of, you know, I don't know, a till receipt?
She did with the first one, now it's just the Rockbusters.
Right.
Really?
She doesn't bother asking how you are, or...
Well, I'll speak to her in a week. Right. On the phone, so yeah.
What kind of conversations would you have, then, with your
stuff? Just do you moan about how overworked you are and stuff to her?
I mean, they're always surprised when I'm getting in late, and that it's like, you know, what have you done today? Well, I've just got in from work, and it's like 8:30 at night.
A lot of people get them at 8:30, Carl. Next.
You know, just saying, how's the flat going?
Yeah.
Asking my dad some DIY tips the other day. You know, usual sort of stuff. We talk to your mum and dad, really.
Yeah.
Talking about the bisons with them. I was did you watch The Mammals in the week? David Attenborough?
No.
I was thinking, actually, right, all this MTV stuff, if there's one reason why I'd like to do it, is I was watching Attenborough, the Mammals programme. I reckon I could do something like that.
Right. Right.
And just have like me instead of Attenborough, like a a young sort of fresh person.
Yeah.
Watching like certain animals and saying, "Do we need these?" Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Oh God! What's it called? Death on Earth. That's amazing. Do we need these?
And,
and the audience at home would vote. Would there be some kind of
vote out system?
Oh, yeah.
The thing is, it's something interesting that Attenborough was saying the other night on
Do we need these?
On Jonathan Ross's show, on his telly show, right? He was saying, he said you could take all the humans off the earth and it would carry on, but take like some animals off it, mammals and that. You got problems on your hands.
Mm.
I thought that was quite interesting.
Yeah.
So it's like the question is, do we need these? Is that part of the big thing?
Right.
Like jellyfish.
Yeah.
We've talked about jellyfish.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So which mammals in particular were you
talked about
that
on the Bull Show, haven't you?
Hey.
Which mammals were you thinking we don't need when you watched the show the other night? Any in particular that you thought they don't need them? They're not of interest.
Well, I like whales, but I don't know what they do.
Okay.
And they're taking up quite a lot of room.
Sure.
But stuff like
quite a lot of room.
Yeah.
But like jellyfish, I looked into because I was talking about them, and they were saying they've got no eyes, no heart. They're something like 97% water.
Yeah.
They're blind and they do about 33 miles a day.
Right.
So it's like, do we need them? Could we clear them out?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, a big net.
That would be like the programme. What right, we'll get rid of them. Next week we'll be looking at
rhinos.
Genius. Yeah. Honestly, I think it's genius. And like going along sort of like picking up sea anemones and going and just lobbing them into the sea.
Well, what do you think about MTV doing that? And then I just in between the bits
play music,
I play music related to fish, so I could play like fish.
Yeah.
That rock guy. Or the rock, animals.
Rock lobster.
Yeah. Or what else could
this
we get
could run
there?
And run.
What other songs have got animals in them? The monkeys? Could play the monkeys?
Yeah, there's about a million, so let's not start this.
No,
yeah.
But, do you know what I mean?
So, do we need this?
So MTV flies you around the world to the most incredible exotic locations. You sort of climb up a tree or whatever next to, I don't know what lives up a tree, some kind of rare parrot. You say, look at that, it's colourful, it's interesting.
Oh, you like sloths, so don't you?
No, they just live up trees, but I'd say, do we need them?
Why?
Well, what do they do?
What do you mean, what do they do? What do you want from an animal? Carpentry. What
well,
do you
like,
want?
I don't like scorpions, right?
Right.
But then I found out they look after those monkey things.
They're not monkeys, they're lizards.
Well, alright, yeah, then lizards. They look after the lizards.
Look
so
at
there's
them.
A reason.
But do you need the lizard? Could be
well,
your next question.
Because the local people made shoes out of them.
But not when the scorpion protected them, they didn't.
Right, we don't need them then.
Okay. So ultimately, you would anyone decide? I mean, do the animals kind of get a chance to mount a case for their survival? I mean, is there maybe someone that comes into their corner and defends them?
I'd have like a David Attenborough type character who says, right. Well, they do this, and I'll go, yeah, but do we need that doing?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
So, yeah.
And so what does an animal need to do in order for you to feel that it sort of gets a chance of life? I mean, like a pet, like an animal, like a dog maybe, or a cat, I mean, they give a certain affection to its owner. Is that a valid reason to survive? Not particularly.
Not really.
No, okay.
I've been saying that though, blind people use dogs, so they are useful.
So dogs are useful.
Farmers
same birds,
use
they
dogs.
Often save people, don't they, in
yeah.
snowy weather?
Cats. I'd have to think about it.
Okay.
Keep the mice down.
Yeah, but you've got rent-a-kill.
Okay.
So what I'm saying is something that will affect the world.
Right. I think you'll find everything does. I think you'll find everything does.
Mm. Except Karl. I'm not sure what effect he's having on the world.
I tell you what though, Steve, right? Did you watch the mammals?
I didn't see the mammals.
They had bison on it.
Right.
The weirdest looking things you've ever seen.
Yeah.
They've really
Again,
got,
you're on dangerous ground here,
know,
Karl.
But they've really got a it's like decide what you want to look like.
Okay.
It's just a mismatch of stuff. It's got a really big airy head.
Yeah.
Unlike you.
Sort of bald at the back.
Right.
Sort of
it's like
thinner.
Someone you went to school with.
Was there two of them? Oh, brilliant. Brilliant. I love the backing as well. Mm. It's just so good. The lyrics, the things you go, they're my favourite band of the year. Next week then. We'll do all our favourite songs of the year, shall we?
No, I think it's got to be 2 weeks, Thomas.
Oh, 2 weeks, is it?
Yeah, I'm away next week as well.
What do you mean you're away next week? What are you doing? Zoe Ball show?
I'm going up north again.
Why?
So Claire's going to be here with you.
Okay. Yeah, at least
what are you doing up north?
She does her job.
Just Suzanne's dad's birthday. So.
I bet he's a party animal. I've heard that they really kick off, don't they? Is it? Yeah.
So
you going to be raving?
Can't concentrate now.
Oh, well, he's all stressed because the lady from MTV is here. She's going to film his little face.
So
the things he said in the week, he was so worried. He's got worried about the spot on his head. That won't come out. Just that you've got your best eyes
on that side. That's all right.
Yeah, there's the camera's out. Look, he's getting nervous now. Okay, Karl, ignore the camera. Okay, just ignore the camera. Okay. Now, me and Steve have done our research for you, and we've got two amazing things to tell you. What's the thing first, about the baby or the
Well, they're
crab?
Both equally fascinating, so you choose.
I'll tell you the crab thing first, right? Steve actually saw this thing in The Guardian the week, about our research thing, and then we looked into it on Friday, and it is incredible. Right, listen to this. There's a thing in a bay in, New England, right, where it's like the biggest, they make silicon chips and stuff for computers, right? And because of the data protection thing, after they've done them, because they have to destroy the plates, right, well, the information's sort of put onto them, but there's still flakes of silicon. They sort of grind it down straight away, and some of the flakes got into the bay, okay? But some of the information's still on the, even the slight granules of silicon. Anyway, gets in the water, and silicon is rather like, a carbon derivative. They reckon if there had been life on another planet that wasn't carbon-based, it'd be silicon-based. Because
right.
That's simple sugars and proteins, it's just COH and that, and it can work with silicon, right? Anyway, the crabs have been taken up, it's on the water, and they looked out on the beach, and, over years, the crabs have started, sort of putting themselves in formations. Like, geometric format, and they couldn't work out why they were doing this. And, when they put them in the experiment, they sort of like chopped them up, and they found they'd taken on silicon. And it had sort of got into their brain, and they were downloading information. They picked up little things, because it's just chemical, you know, like, electrical impulses had got information off the silicon chip, and they were interfacing it. But, this is the amazing thing, one bloke sort of thought of this, and he thought, well, if it's a simple computer, the brain, if it's just a simple sort of electrical thing, then maybe there's sort of, you know, we could get it down. So what they did is they made a thing called a biointerface. And they put it into the crab's brain, just a really simple brain, so it's medulla oblongata, right? And it got impulses from it, and they were getting like computer readers, it's just flashes of like symbols and geometric things were on this screen to read the crowd's brain, and it was stuff like, you know, fragments of a
what made them do this in the first place?
Because they saw that they saw the crowds behaving differently. They were behaving differently to each other. They were just like, they were, you know, intelligent, and they were sort of solving problems and all this sort of stuff. Anyway, when they downloaded the thing, it was like a they found one of the secretary's names where it had been on the silicon chip, where it was just a, like a flash of a computer screen. But the most amazing thing is, they downloaded a memory, right? It was like a snapshot where it had been burnt onto the retina of the crab, just a snapshot or something, and it was like a picture of the beach, like a couple of years ago, right? And they also did, incredible, it was like a, just a digital black and white sort of thing, so they could see what the crab had seen.
Amazing.
Jeez.
Amazing.
So intelligent crabs. What are they doing with them now,
super brain?
Well, they think, this is the upshot, they think they could use it as spy crabs, because they could put these, get these crabs. Also, the other thing is, as generations went on, right, so they put a crab in the sea or something, right, lots of crabs in, and then as generations went on, a newborn crab, they downloaded the memory, and it had the memories of it's great, 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 all together. It had every memory that any crab had been related to it beforehand. Because it passed it on, it just passed it on.
So not even ones that had been eating the silicon stuff?
Yeah, no,
these are just like ones that have had kids.
Yeah.
And they've got like,
and they know every, so you'd know everything, your great, great, everything right the way back.
So would that work if we ate silicon?
Well, possibly.
So what are they gonna,
well, they can use them for all sorts of things, though. I mean, that's what's incredible. I mean, I don't know how you train it particularly. I don't know, quite tricky to train, but I'm assuming if they could, if they can do it that way, then presumably they can.
It'd be
it
like loads
of silicon information, which they can then plant in it, if you like, within its sort of food.
Also, if you get them onto enemy beaches, you'd have like 1,000 digital cameras just
sneaking around. If you get like, you know, Osama bin Laden or someone, just
they don't
around
they
in
don't
the
understand
sand.
The information they've got.
No, they don't know they're doing it. They just download
them. So they're not like you could torture them, and they won't be able to sort of give you the information, because they wouldn't know what the information they had, because they're just
but
like
the crab, the first crab they downloaded, they just kept seeing the same picture of a big crab feeding it, which they
really?
Yeah.
Wow. That's what, like its mother crab or something?
Yeah. As just it was memories of it as a child.
But they're not in colour, presumably, because
no, it's all in black and white. It's just a digital camera, because it's just a, they don't see in black and white, so it's just like a, I think it's burnt onto the retina or something. And, the only one that they kept were the ones they saw a lot of the time.
Well, I mean, in a way, some of the educating Ricky I've got for you today is on the similar lines.
Right.
Oh, you've got to be impressed by that. You've got to be impressed by that.
No, that's pretty good. I mean, I'm interested to see, you know,
what the crab developments are.
But yeah, no, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
But, I mean, amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Well, just digest that information, because that's not even the most impressive one we've found.
I think it is.
I suppose it's pretty impressive, but the next one's maybe more shocking.
Okay, right.
But let's play a tune, and Ricky's got another experience.
Okay.
Love song, classic, on XFM.
So that's the crab that can, you can download their memories.
But what about other animals that are in the sea, in that same sea, eating the stuff? Have they tested them yet?
I don't know. I think they just took it on because their biology, something to do with, I presume they could take up minerals and, you know, I don't know why. I don't know. But anyway, next one, this is on Horizons, a bodybuilder, yeah? Married another bodybuilder, yeah. Right, and they were pregnant, and they had these tests, and the baby was very large, but it was causing it pain, right, in the thing, right, and it, after this,
it's almost bizarre, and like,
yeah, after the female woke up pregnant after 7 months, and the baby
walking around.
No, it forced its way out of the vagina.
Oh, no way.
Yeah, it forced its way out.
It almost had super strength. Like,
and it was pulling her along by the umbilical cord, and that, and it was a stone.
Extraordinary. That, no, that's freaky. I mean, you talk about freaky stuff.
That's made up.
What?
It wasn't pulling her along.
She could feel it.
Exactly. And it was, do you know what I mean? Like, just went and just sort of squeezed
just
its way
got out because it was ready because all the hormones
because it thought
stuff.
It was ready.
Oh god,
imagine that, just waking up and finding that in the bottom of the bed freak you out, wouldn't it? Because you'd think it was a nightmare initially.
And it had hair and everything, didn't it?
Yeah, because all the hormones, you know, like a hair almost has a beard.
There was something in the week about, you know, you've got test tube babies and that now, haven't you? Mm. But they've managed to do it. I only caught half
I knew
story.
He'd be more impressed by the crabs than that. He doesn't care if it's
No,
human.
I am. I'm telling you. I'm telling you, though, that, there was something. I only caught half the story because I was busy. But, there's something about babies being able to be born without having any people involved. Or something. It's like putting them in an oven or something, and it's like a cake. And after a certain amount of time, it's ready.
I remember buying those in Argos for kids.
Well, it's Christmas. Well,
it's my first baby kit.
Yeah. It's Play-Doh, I think, that they can buy.
Yeah. So what do you think of that, then?
The baby one.
Yeah.
I prefer the crab one.
Yeah.
But the baby, I mean, the baby thing's pretty horrible.
Yeah.
So it was bigger than like the average.
But, both made up. We made those up.
Yeah, they're both rubbish. Despite the fact they're both rubbish.
Yeah.
They're interesting.
We made those up. Both those stupid stories up.
Yeah.
Imagine downloading a crab's memories and seeing its mum feeding it as a child.
I had trouble.
Yeah. I knew I was gonna have trouble with pushed its way out of the vagina.
Yeah.
I practiced that about 30 times yesterday with Stephen. I was going, I'm not gonna be able to do it, mate.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna be able to say that.
Yeah.
Are you disappointed?
A little bit. I mean, the baby one's a bit sort of out there.
Yeah.
I wasn't really having that one.
No.
But the crab one,
See, now, what's interesting, I think, is a useful experiment, Karl. I don't know what it's taught you about yourself. But would you say that that's revealed to you a certain thing? I don't know, maybe... That you're a bit gullible. I mean, you know, what I'm saying is maybe you shouldn't accept or swallow your hook, line and sinker everything you read on the web. You got to think maybe a valuable lesson.
I feel bad because I said to Steve, he won't be annoyed that we conned him, he'd be annoyed that they're actually not true. You'd love that crab thing to be true, wouldn't you?
It wouldn't surprise me if it did happen one day.
Sure. Yeah.
So, and then he's laughing.
And he said, in the rake, when I said about the crabs, you went, well, I'm keeping them then.
Yeah.
Right, well, I know what you're getting at. with the educating Ricky, but, you know.
Let's see.
You've got, three titles.
Yeah.
That I tease you with, different stories. You take your pick and I teach you something that did happen.
A little bit of venom. Yeah, go on.
First one is, don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher.
I bet that's bacon related, knowing you.
You've got enough is anus.
Say that again.
Enough is anus.
Enough is enough.
Well.
But it's changed to enough is an anus.
Yeah. And you've got,
yeah.
You've also got, will it be a bloke? Oh no. Will it like a bloke or a woman?
What?
Will it like a bloke or a woman?
Will it?
Yeah.
Will it like a bloke or a woman?
Wow.
Yeah, so there are your three stories.
Okay,
today.
Sounds exciting.
Okay, well, I'll have Woolit.
Well,
like
we're going to play a record now, Rick, surely.
Yeah, okay.
And come back with.
Sorry about the crabs and the big baby.
It's alright.
He went, I said, just look at the camera. He went, right, do you want to know about MTV? He went, well, it might be VH1. He went, right. He did Rockbusters, then did After the Break, some Genesis.
I'd watch it.
You didn't tell me she wanted all this. I thought you said, because I said, you just bring your own camera in and we'll put it down on some tape and pass that on to her.
Yeah.
So now, this I'm doing two jobs at once again. This is what I'm saying to you in the week. I'm juggling jobs all the time. I tell you.
Right, come on then.
How much do I get?
He looked straight at the camera and said that.
Right. So, three stories. Don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher. Enough is anus. And,
we'll have that one then.
That one?
Yeah.
Right, well, do you believe in palm reading and stuff?
No. Yes. Sorry, yes. Yep, of course. Sorry, I forgot. Yes, of course we do.
Mm-hmm. Right, well, there's a fella who, he used to do palm reading.
No, yeah.
But a lot of people, he found that when he went up to him in the street and said, do you want your palm reading? He was like, a lot of them were like, you know, oh, I'm a bit ashamed of my nails and stuff because they're a labourer or they're a cleaner or something like that.
I know a lot of labourers are slightly embarrassed by their nails.
Yeah. No, but...
Yeah.
So if
look at my bloody hands, Reg.
Well...
That's that hod carrying.
Did I ever tell you that? Did I ever tell you that I got picked at school to make tea and serve biscuits to old people because I've got good nails?
No, go on. Is there any more to the story?
Oh, that's about it. I mean, We used to do, like, I think the head teacher must have been getting something, maybe getting his mam in there for free or something in some people's app. So, so, he offered the kids at the school, he said, right, all sit at your desk and put your hands on the table. And everyone did. And he walked past me and he said, not bad, not bad. Yeah. And he said, you've got the afternoon off, you can go and serve biscuits and tea to the old people.
What did you say?
I said, all right then.
Was that?
Yeah. It was a good afternoon. But anyway,
what
so these-
yeah,
well,
what did he do?
He just sort of walked around and went, all right, do you want bourbons or digest?
I bet you'd get on with old people, wouldn't you? Yeah, I'd love to see you, maybe-
Especially the senile ones.
Yeah, no, but I'd love to see you on VH1, just do a link, and just go, you know, they've just played, Robert Palmer, right? And it comes to you in a little park, and you just sit next to an old lady, go, all right? And you go, yeah, not too bad. You go, what do you think of London? Crap, innit? And she goes, yeah, it's awful, innit? And you just have a talk, and you go, all right, well, she doesn't like it, in excess. Yeah. That's what I'd like to see.
Mm. I still think my idea is better, but. Mm-hmm. So what are you going for then? Oh, you've picked one, haven't you? yeah, so this fella.
So there's palmists going around the streets.
Yeah, he's going around and
randomly trying to give palm readings.
They're losing money hand over fist.
Yeah.
Right. So, they said, he's reading people's, bottoms now.
Sorry, whoa. You just I didn't quite follow that. He was a palm reader, that wasn't making money, so now he's going up to people in the street and saying, can I see your arse?
Basically, yeah.
So from being a palmist to an arsonist?
Well, they just, that's what he does. He said the same sort of lines and that you get on your hand, you get them on your bottom, and he can read them.
Right.
Yeah, he's not a pervert or anything, or making up as he goes along.
No, that's it, that was that.
So, sorry, if a man came up to you in the street and said, can I have a look at your arse?
Can I read your arse?
You'd drop your trousers, would you?
No. If you went up to him and they said, oh, I'd rather you didn't because I'm a labourer, I've got bad fingernails.
No, that's why I've seen, that's what a lot of labourers, they're showing their cleavage, you think, but actually they're having their arse read.
Absolutely.
That's what it is.
And then, right.
So is that the end of the story?
Yeah. But then because-
That's it. Educating Ricky is there's a bloke who reads arses.
No, but
you're
then,
a mentalist.
But no, but
what are you talking about?
But then, do you know, like, now and again I come up with a little jokey line. Thought I'd make an effort today for VH1 or MTV.
Yeah.
Little line there. don't worry, it won't last. It might just be a splash in the pan.
Okay.
Phil Collins next.
Yes,
I hope you aren't enjoying it as much as we are, but Carl is continuing his, what do they call this? A screen test.
Mm.
Yeah, that was let down by Radiohead. Carl, what are you thinking?
I just think it's not right, really, is it? I'm trying to do a job whilst trying to get another job.
Yeah, but a lot of your presenters are on MTV now.
Yeah, but...
all of them have got Zane in their name, but, you know...
Yeah, it's not really right, is it?
Go on. But,
right, so,
you better get that out of here. Karl Zane Pilkington.
Educating Ricky, will we carry on?
Yeah.
Right, you've got left. Don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher. And, will it like fellas or will it like women?
Well, you said wool before.
Yeah, wool it.
Go on then, I've wool it.
Right, now this is similar to the one you were talking about before, right? They found out that,
they.
Yeah. Scientists.
Oh, yeah.
Have found out.
17th century?
That, like now, 1 in 10 rams are gay.
1 in 10 rams are gay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that was like, wool it. That's how I could get that in. they got a load of gay and straight rams.
Right.
Right. they worked out which were which first. They said, right, that bunch there is a gay bunch.
They looked better, they just had more pride in their appearance.
And the other ones, you know, the straight ones, and then they gave them to this scientist and said, right, go on, do what you gotta do. And they took the brains out of all of them.
Just to check.
And they did tests on the brain and it worked out that they've got something smaller in the brain. The gay ones have got something in the brain that makes it smaller. And they said, right, well, that's probably how it's gonna work on males. On like males and females and like humans.
So you took from this that gays have smaller brains than straight people?
No, there's something in the brain.
Right,
so if someone's saying, you know, oh, I'm a gay, or they're not sure or whatever, they will now be able to find out.
So you can go to the doctor and to find out if you're straight or gay.
Is there any gay in my brain? Let's have a look. Do 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 do. You've got a little bit of a gay in you. Yes, a little bit of a gay in there. Yes, you've got the you've got a little bent cell there.
Well, that's why they did it anyway.
I don't understand how they could differentiate which were straight and which were gay to begin with, before they then gave it to the scientist. Wasn't that what the scientist figured out?
How could they tell?
There's
one theory that it's genetically determined. There is a theory that's genetically determined, but I don't think it's as easy as pulling a sheep's brain apart and finding a little pink sort of like blob in there, going right, we've taken the gay out, and now he's going to go and shag some ewes. I don't think it's that straightforward. Although homosexuality does occur a similar sort of rate in animals, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you knew that, didn't you?
So that's that one. I mean,
I just like the idea of a farmer figuring out which is straight and gay. Well, yeah. That one's wearing quite a camp-looking neckerchief.
Yeah,
so I'm thinking maybe
yeah.
It's gay.
Is that? Yeah. Yeah. I love the fact that they can. Okay.
That was a big fan of Sophie Ellis Bextor.
Yeah. They would. They put on ABBA and see which ones dance.
Exactly.
That's how they.
Which one? Yeah. Put on like Barbara Streisand and see which ones sing along.
That is rubbish. What did I find out?
Did you just say that is rubbish?
No, I found out other stuff in the week that didn't make the top three.
Wow. We haven't even had
this. No. Must be mediocre stuff. This must be really bad.
Yeah. But or it might be dubious. Go on.
There's a woman in Ireland.
Yeah.
Who has been with a fella for 11 years.
Yeah.
She always saying to him, you know, when are we going to get married and that? And he's like, oh, we don't need to. You know, we're happy and that. You know, like I am with Suzanne, it's like, there's no point, really.
Yeah,
unless you have a kid, I don't think you need to, do you?
Right.
So, he was like, we'll do it in time and all that. Anyway, he comes home from work one day, he says, oh, go on then, we'll get married. She was so shocked, her hair fell out.
Oh. Did you get that? Wow.
So.
That's extraordinary.
And what did he say? Oh, I'm not marrying you, Baldy.
Yeah. Well,
she was so shocked her hair fell out.
Yeah.
I love the idea of it just going to the ground.
Fell out. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. What else?
That's rubbish. Next.
You've also got,
it's weird, isn't it, Rick, that the stories that we made up are more plausible than the facts you actually
given. I think we tried too hard.
That's what he's willing to believe. He's willing to believe that a woman's hair fell out when her husband came out and said, let's get married then. Oh, you old romantic.
Well, now then, here's a good one.
Go on then.
Right, in Dubai, this woman went to Dubai for a holiday. And, she was over there, and apparently in the markets- They sell lizards.
Oh, go on.
Right, just like for people to buy. Mm. So she buys one, not knowing that you're not really meant to take him out of the country.
Sure.
Puts it in a bag.
Yeah, as you do.
What have you. And, then she gets to the airport when she's going home, she's thinking, I can't really leave it in my bag.
Yeah.
So she puts it on her head.
Where's her head?
Wears it as a hat.
She wore the lizard as a hat?
Yeah. People on the plane were just like, yeah, everything's fine, you know, they're doing the cross checks and that.
Yeah.
Have you got your seatbelt on? Yeah.
There's a woman there with a lizard hat.
Everything's going well. She gets off the plane at Manchester Airport. Lizard sticks its tongue out.
Yeah.
The air hostess says, what are you doing with that? She goes, I've had it.
Lizard said, I just found her in Dubai.
They said, I've had this with me all journey, and they said, well, you shouldn't have done, and they took it off her.
Yeah, I think that is true, actually.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So what about that?
Yeah, good, yeah. Yeah. That educated me. Right, what, any more?
Well, what's that taught you? That's taught you, you know, be careful when smuggling lizards back as some kind of hat.
Yeah, just say, lizard, keep your tongue in, you twat. Not at the customs officer! Yeah.
And, what else have
we got? Anyone didn't quite make it?
Anything to declare?
I've got
a lizard on my head.
We've got an old saying one if you want that.
Go on then.
Are these ones that didn't make the list?
These are ones that didn't make it.
Oh, right, okay.
Because I always get more in than I need to, just in case.
Just think if someone's just tuned in now. Mm. Is Anders listening? Dickie Anderson.
I've got an email from Richard Anderson, Dickie Anderson.
Go on.
The Dick Machine, which-
The Big Dick,
which- no, this is interesting. I think we're wearing him down. Ricky, I think your show might be improving.
Go on.
That sense of despair and loneliness I normally feel when listening to your show doesn't seem so bad today.
He's desensitized to it.
Yeah, exactly.
Always giving up. Always just giving up. Yeah. I mean, you listen to this long enough and your standards will drop.
Let's play a tune. Let's come back with some more.
A ride track from about 10 or 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So if you know, put me out of my misery, email in. It's just like a ride track from about 1990. And I can't, it's just the beginning.
Uh-huh.
Drive me mental.
Ricky.Gervais at xfm.co.uk.
Yeah, well, half hour to go. You've done your screen test.
Yeah.
Reluctantly. I think you had such the wrong attitude.
Well, it doesn't matter, does it? If, I've told you before, if things are meant to be, right, they'll happen. That's how I've got through my life, right? I'm 29 now.
Yeah.
Never
30,
played.
Yeah?
Well, yeah. 30, but the camera's still on. Right? So, and everything I've done in my life, I've never sort of planned it. Do you know
Is that
I mean?
How you stormed through your exam?
Well, look at the school play doing Little Donkey. I wasn't planning that day to do the drums. It just, on the night, I couldn't help myself.
And you stole the show.
What happened? What do you mean?
When all the kids were playing Little Donkey, I wasn't meant to be doing my drum set in that track. I was only meant to, I think I was doing We Three Kings or something.
Uh-huh.
But when they started doing it, the tune, I couldn't help myself with the drumstick just like tapping away.
Right.
At the drum.
Yeah.
And then when it came on, I was like, oh, and I started doing it and like the teacher looked over at me and I was like, oh, I shouldn't be doing this. But she sort of gave me the nod as if to say, it's all right, carry on, it's sounding good. Then after it, she went, you know, they love that, you can do that again tomorrow night.
Yeah.
So I got like an extra part in the play and that.
Yeah.
That wasn't
so
planned.
So you were doing the drum part to We Three Kings over Little Donkey.
Yeah.
That's weird, that is like Fatboy Slim or something, isn't it, when they mix up.
No.
Well, no.
You're mashing it up at the age of what, 8?
Yeah. No. And that's what I'm saying.
And that, is that when, is that when, someone was filming it and you could hear your dad on the camcorder going, he looks like a twat?
That's the one, yeah.
Oh.
And that's why, maybe that's why I don't want to be on the telly, because I'll always have my dad's sort of echoing voice just saying, he shouldn't be on there, he looks like a, that's it. So that's why I'm a bit sort of nervous about this today.
Really? You think it's sort of quite Freudian in a way, sort of?
Yeah.
You're actually this case around Sarah.
Well, plus I haven't got the look. I'm not pretending, right, that I should be on the telly.
What's wrong with your look for VH1?
It's not right. It's not
Jono
right.
Jono was on VH1.
Was he?
Yes.
So I'm going up against Jono?
No.
So
he's gone now, he's moved on.
Yeah, there you go, you see, another one who they gave a chance to,
yeah.
And then he was like, you know, yeah, I can do that. It's built up, right? They built him up, you can do that as a job. And then they knocked him down. And he probably started eating.
Well, I don't think you can knock Jono down.
He started eating! He started eating!
Look at him now.
Yeah.
Right,
oh.
So that's what I'm saying. So if it's meant to be, right, whoever's gonna watch this tape, you know, thanks for the offer and that. But, you know, time will tell.
Very wise,
so,
yeah.
There you go. And I tell you what, actually.
Go on.
It's a bit funny because we're looking on the web in a week at different sayings. And, do you know the saying?
A round head does not an MTV presenter
no,
make.
Yeah, no. What's that saying? Spark in the pan or something?
Hey, eh? Flash in the pan?
Flash in the pan,
yeah.
Do you know that saying?
Yeah.
That's a bit like what could happen to me, innit? Do you know what I mean? There I am trying to do my normal job, right? And then you bring me in here on a Saturday, next thing everyone's after me.
Yeah.
And then it doesn't work out and I'm dropped.
Yeah.
And that saying, flash in the pan, do you know how it came about?
No.
Do you know like how years ago they used to dig for gold?
Gold.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And they had like a little pan.
Yeah.
And they'd put the soil in, and they'd rub the soil.
Yeah, and it shone in the sun.
Now and again, it shone in the sun, and they'd get all excited, and we're like, oh, brilliant, some gold. And then they realised it was just the sun flashing in the pan.
Yeah.
And that's, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So again, that's a bit weird, I saw that saying in the week. Almost like a little thing saying, don't be getting carried away.
Omen.
So, well, makes you wonder. But anyway.
Not really.
So, tell you, things that make you wonder, you saw Darren Brown, what did he do?
Darren Brown,
he's extraordinary.
Yeah, I told him about this.
You should a lot of people don't realise who Darren Brown is, and he's, I think, the best illusionist in the country.
We went to Jonathan Ross's house for his birthday.
I didn't.
Me and Jane, and we went there, right, and there was lots of people there. And Darren Brown was there, and Jonathan got Darren Brown too, so, and it was incredible. He did all these tricks, right? I mean, incredible. It was just amazing. And he did one with a bloke who was there, a friend of Jonathan's, I think his name was Ray. And he got him to give the pack, he said, count the cards, and he counted out 52 cards.
Yeah?
But yeah, he went, think of any card in that pack. He didn't touch it yet, he's counted 52, it was in his hand, he said, think of any card. He said, what was it? He said, three of spades or something. He went, find it in the pack, couldn't find it. He said, count the cards, there was 51. Right, and he couldn't find the card, and he hadn't heard it. And we forgot about it, he went, oh, it's gone wrong, and he forgot about it. And he kept, so he was going, I wonder where that card is, and he kept looking at it, I found out that about a week ago, Ray went into hospital with an appendicitis. Yeah? And the surgeon, as we say, they said his stomach crumpled up. There was this little thing. And it was a card. It was the card that was in his thing causing appendicitis. And when he came out of surgery, there was a card from Darren Brown saying, was that your card?
That's amazing, don't you think? I mean,
this
that's
is
like
a,
incredible.
Little thing and what? And then a crab went, I don't know what it is. It's a five of spades. It's another wind up.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, see. See, I'm not going to believe anything anymore.
But that's so good. You've learned a lesson.
Yeah, but say if all this goes wrong now, right? Cry wolf and all that.
Yeah.
Imagine I get dropped by MTV.
You haven't been asked yet.
Yeah, well, whatever. Right, they're short on firemen because they're always going on strike. I answer the phone, it's you saying my house is on fire.
I don't know what you're talking about now, Carl. I don't know what he's talking about.
I think somewhere along the line there, Carl has been recruited by the fire brigade.
Did you leave that bit out in the story? Start again.
Yeah,
right.
That's what
right,
I'm saying.
Because I just wound you up about crabs, babies pushing their way out of vaginas, yeah. And Darren Brown causing offense. Right, yeah.
Little, What's the saying about,
little acorns don't gather any grounds.
Crying wolf.
You can take a fish to water and you can't make a swim.
Do you know, that saying? You can lead a horse to water but you can't make it drink. Do you know why?
Cause its neck's too long.
What?
It's got an awkward neck. I don't know.
That's correct. That is correct.
Right, anyway, we've still got to come.
Right,
it's been bad today. I'm going to apologise to people listening today because
you might not be
focused.
Have you heard the thing that Rolling Stone gathers no moss? You aware of that?
Yeah.
Do you know where that's from?
Where it's from?
In Woodstock, right, the band used to go out and get this sort of like moss that used to grow there and it was sort of like slightly hallucinogenic, right? And they used to come back and they used to all go out, everyone was out there, mamas and papas were doing it, the Doors, they all came back. But Mick Jagger and Keith Richards would never do it. But they'd smoke other people's.
Yeah.
A Rolling Stone never gathers his own moss. That was what it was.
Seriously, Carl?
Right,
that's
so
the truth.
We've still got to come. Rockbusters.
Have you heard the saying, a fish in time saves nine?
The clues were.
Have you heard that?
That'll never get off the ground. LZ. You've got.
Have you heard that saying, out of the frying pan into the saucepan?
You've
Have
also
you heard
got.
Carl.
I'm trying to hold it together now.
Well, yeah. No, we're trying to teach you something, Carl.
Yeah, but you're not.
Why?
Because at least my stuff that I tell you, if you go into a pub and told someone.
What? There was a blind girl, she hit her head, she could see. What's that?
Well, just don't get down if your eyes are bad.
go round headbutting
thing. It's one of the tracks on the best air guitar album in the world ever, Volume 2, which is one of the prizes on today's Rockbusters.
And John Peel's favourite track ever.
John Peel's favourite song of all time. And so, Carl, have you got the answers for Rockbusters this week?
Yeah, we have, yeah. We've got the first clue.
You're upset,
so
Carl.
Miserable.
I'm a bit fed up today. The weather's. I knew when I was walking in today, though, that I'd be.
But that video, there's lots of weather on that video, so they can. Whoever wins this can go home and see sort of the weather you were talking about.
The first one was, that'll never get off the ground. LZ.
Yeah.
The answer there was Led Zeppelin.
So easy.
Yeah, but I said that to you. There's always two easy ones and a difficult one.
Go on.
The third one was, you'll get a load of bacon off them.
Go on.
That was L. Long pigs.
Right.
Yeah. And then the second one was, that woman's got her husband's gloves and a pair of her own.
Yeah.
HH.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was Erman's Hermits. So that's the three answers. I'm sure
well, I'll give the prize this week.
This Hermann's Hermits. That is genius, Carl. Oh, Hermann's Hermits.
So, there's so many people who are worthy of the prizes, obviously.
Hermits.
I'd quite like to give the prize this week to Tom McGibbon. Just because I like his name, I don't know if I pronounced that right, but Tom McGibbon.
Yeah.
I'd like to give that to him.
No, you shouldn't laugh at Tom's
name. He also lives in Bloxhall Road. I don't know why I find that. Tom McGibbon of Bloxhall Road. I don't know why.
Well, you've made a mockery of, you've made a monkey out of the man.
Poor old Gibbo.
Yeah.
And he's asking that, he's got a question there.
What?
Can Carl get rid of slugs? I don't know what that means. I'm almost certain he can. Just so well done to,
if he's been listening, if he was listening a few months ago, he would have known how to.
Go on.
Because I told you what slugs like.
What?
Getting in letterboxes.
How does that get rid of them?
Put some stamps in your garden. They like, they like stamp glue. So,
yeah. And how does that get rid of them? They keep coming back, won't they? Then they're going, I can't believe it. We'd have to climb those boxes now. There's a fella leaving stamps
just
out for us.
Go. You've won some prizes and I've sorted you.
No, how does that get rid of slugs? Leaving stamps out for them, their favourite food.
Because
it's like planting a load of lettuces. They love that.
Well, it depends where he's got them. I thought he meant he's got them in his house.
Okay. Oh, to put stamps on the outside. There go. There's loads of stamps out here, lads. Let's leave this house.
Right. So
let's get out of this house.
We've got one more.
Go on.
Educating Ricky to
go on and quick then. And I need educating.
Right. Don't rub it too hard. You'll get a rasher.
How was he going to outwit Derren Brown? You said something in the break.
Oh, I have to say, yeah. Derren Brown, who we bumped into as well, and he did this incredible trick where he puts £40 down on the table. He says, "I can tell you which hand you've got a pound coin in. Let's say 5 times out of 5. You know, so I have a pound coin in one hand. I put it behind my back. I bring my hands out, and he can tell me every single time which hand it's in by asking questions, by doing various.
Well, he doesn't ask, but he just goes, "No, you might have put it in that one. You might do the same again. But then you're an intelligent person. You're praying that one. He goes, "So it's in that one," and he does it every time. Yeah, it's incredible.
It's absolutely majestic. I mentioned this to Karl.
Yeah.
And, well, Karl, you tell me how you think you could outwit Derren Brown. Because your dad used to do this trick,
My dad used to play this. Yeah.
How old were you?
I don't know, probably about 10.
So you probably weren't as sharp as you were now, then?
So he used to play it, and the way of telling what hand he's got it in, his hand looks bigger. So that's what you've got to do.
That's how he did it, then! Yeah.
To catch Derren out.
Different because he did it with golf balls, but.
But to catch Derren out, Karl told me, Rick.
He did it with a spud.
To catch Derren out,
yeah.
The hand which hasn't got the coin in, just make it slightly bigger. Just make it just like extend it slightly so it's slightly larger, and that'll catch Derren out. He'll never be able to stop
that's
that.
How he did it.
Or just put a pound in each hand.
Okay.
And wind him up. Just go, no, you're wrong.
You are brilliant, Karl. Yeah. Do this one.
Did your dad used to do the one where he takes your nose off off of your face and puts it between his fingers?
Did you keep going to the doctors?
Yeah.
Yeah, go on.
Right.
You know how that's done? You know he's not actually taking your nose off.
It's his thumb. Go on.
It is his thumb.
Last one.
Yeah.
Don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rash. It's been a mess today.
What do you mean it's been a mess?
It's been a mess.
What has?
This.
What? The show?
Yeah.
How has it been any worse?
It's just all over the place. There's no sort of, it's not tight like it generally is. And she'll be going away with this, thinking that's what the show would be like.
She listens to the show, she knows it's a shambles every week. Go on.
Yeah. Don't rub it too hard, you'll get a rasher.
Yeah.
Do you know the saying, ham it up?
yeah, go on, yeah.
Right, well, do you know what it means?
Well, it means to overact.
Right. Well, years ago, with actors in musicals and stuff, the actors used to look pretty ill on the stage because they didn't have proper makeup and that.
Right.
Right. So what they used to do to make themselves look
rub their face in pigs.
Well, they got bacon, rubbed it on the face, and it made the face a bit sticky because of all the the pig fat and bit of lard and stuff like that. And then they'd go and get some bricks.
Bricks.
Yeah. House bricks. Rub them together, make some sort of red dust from the brick, and then put the dust on the face, and the fat and the lard and that would make the dust stick to the face, and they'd look well under the light. And that's where the
they smell great as well.
Yeah, well.
They're lovely. Everyone likes the smell of bacon.
No, but, so that's the old ham it up, that's where
that
comes from.
If it's true, I've no reason to think that it's not.
So that's your third Educating Ricky today. So, what have you learned?
Nothing. Absolutely sod all.
You've got your hamming it up.
Yeah.
Rams are gay. They know which ones are gay now. And,
at last, thank God.
The fella who can hand read, an arse.
If you miss the rest of the show, what are you gonna make of that? Have you just tuned in?
You are a maniac, Karl.
So,
and you've had your screen test. I reckon we'll be seeing you on MTV or VH1 in the near future.
How much is it? How much? I mean, she can't answer. What do you reckon I'll get? Because I've, you see, the annoying thing is, I've just bought a flat in London.
Yeah.
In central London.
Yeah.
MTV's in Camden.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have bought in central London if I'd have known I'd had to go there. That was to make my life easier so I could walk to work. So now I've got to go out of my way. So I need to cover that.
To be truthful, I'm not sure that the MTV gig is a certainty. Yet.
She's pretending she's not sure, but she can't wait to sign you up.
Yeah. I reckon maybe start off with a few little interstitials. Just like, what do you think, make of that? Or Karl says, few of them. I reckon you'll make a, you know, a few grand.
Why has it got to be music? Why can't it be? I think that idea on the animals is good. I can do film stuff. I can talk about films. Elephant Man. Love that.
Go on then, do a film review, quickly.
Right, well today on film review, we're doing classic films, and today we're looking at Elephant Man, John Merrick, one of his better pieces of work. It's a sad film. I've never really been able to watch it all the way through.
Sorry, John Merrick's better piece of work was him being the Elephant Man, played by John Hurt.
Yeah.
Go on then.
Sad film. When I was younger.
Tell us a bit about it. What is it about?
Who's John Merrick? It's about a fella who's got a funny head.
Right, tell us this.
And you know, he lives in, I think he lives in London, in like the, about in the 1930s or something like that. And he's being picked on all the time and stuff.
Mm.
And first time you watch it, you'll probably cry a bit. And then the second time you watch it, you're just sort of thinking, God, that would be bad. Sort of having a head like that being picked on all the time. And the third time you watch it, you might think, you know, oh, how does he get his jumper on? Then, I don't know, I'm probably bored of it the fourth time. but it's well worth watching, so Elephant Man.
Brilliant.
Yeah, see it.
Brilliant.
I think if you want to get on TV, Carl, you'd be better as the subject of maybe like an omnibus documentary. Living with Carl. Or maybe one of those appeals in comic relief. It doesn't all go to the people abroad, you know. There's some people in this country that need our help.
What is it?
That's the Libertines, Time for Heroes.
Oh, yeah. So, Carl, what a great day. Carl, he's done his screen test. That's going back to MTV now to look at the big wigs to have a look at. Yeah. Shouldn't mention wigs. We've had Rockbusters. We've had Educating Ricky. We had Educating Carl.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Claire here next week, so.
Yeah.
But you'll be back for the big Christmas spectacular.
Yeah, and that's that. I've not been happy today.
Go on, why?
If someone's listened for the first time today, it is normally better than this.
It's not.
No, it is.
I don't think it is.
So I really
don't think it is.
So that's that then. So I'll see you in
2 weeks.
2 weeks, yeah.
All right, enjoy yourself. Cheers. Best of luck with MTV.
All right, I'll see you later.
Okay.
See ya.
Cheers.